guides. Hear our prayers, O Lord. O Lord, we've failed in our devotion to you. Forgive us. We've reduced your priority to a to-do list and put you way at the bottom. Forgive us, Lord. Invigorate us. Allow us to turn that to-do list upside down so you're at the top where you ought to be and should be and can be and will be. Forgive us, Lord, for not making the community of the saints, your church, a priority in our lives. Forgive us, Lord, for not understanding how we can grow and develop and mature and be invigorated in Christ by being together. We pray, Lord God, you'll forgive us as we raise the community of Christ higher in our to-do list and our priority list also. And also, Lord, forgive us for not seeking the enjoyment we have through the Church of Jesus Christ. Forgive us, Lord, for assuming it's not fun, assuming the joy you give through your church is not something that's important. Forgive us, Lord, as we pray for these concerns we've already listed. Hear our prayers, Lord.
Christ was raised from the dead. Death came through a human being, Adam. The resurrection of the dead also came through a human being, Jesus, the God-man. All die in Adam, but all can be made alive in Christ.
Please be seated, saints. Coming back here today because you're out here and I'm here. One for you. One for you. Oh, that one got dropped. I'll get it. You got yours? Okay. One for you. Imagine that these slips of paper are people. Imagine these slips of paper are all just individuals. And they're all wonderful in God's eyes. But they're all disconnected from each other, even though they're sitting together in the Church of Jesus Christ in pews close to each other. But they don't know much of anything about each other, and they don't know how they need support from one another, and they don't really know what brings them joy and happiness. I'm wondering, is that probably pretty true? Yeah. Well, one of the blessings of the church is that we have this guy named Jesus who binds us together, and then we, because we've chosen to be together, he says, well, there's one of you. Put you in there. And there's another one of you. Oh my gosh, you two have a lot in common. I saw you greet each other when you came in. God's got other plans for you in community. And those are together. Oh, and you're related to him. He can bring you along to those meetings. In fact, I know you two. I know that you brought him into Christ when he was about 40. Well, about 40. That's when he knew everything except Jesus. And you introduced him to Jesus. I do know that. And you, I know your name. And you probably know things about these folks that I don't know. Would you like to share that with me?
No.
No. Bang. And I know you're very active in the Church of Jesus Christ, but you probably don't know the things about the Simpsons and the Simpsons. Simpsons. Springers, I'm sorry. That maybe I don't, or the others don't. So we can share those things together and be stronger together. And my insurance agent is over there. And I think that's a good thing. And so my point is, Christ, the binder clip of our lives, brings us together, not so we can count you on Sunday morning, but so that your being here will encourage you to connect with each other during the week, binding one another to our... We live in this culture now that doesn't do that very well, do we? I mean, when was the last time you were at my house for dinner? Never. But we were on the front porch. Yeah. And so the idea is we're here together as a church for the specific reason that we get closer with each other than just the pews. That's the beauty of the church. Showing up on Sunday morning is great, but making connections during the week is the purpose that we show up on Sunday morning. That's the theme for today, and helping youth connect with that understanding. God bless you. And you will be coming to my house for dinner, but it's not going to be good. Okay. Because you know me. If it's in a can, a box, or a bag, I can heat it up.
Okay, a couple announcements as Jim's making his way back. Oh, and children are dismissed for children's ministry. A couple announcements. Preschool open house. If you go downstairs, we're recovering from a wonderful 2 days at Vacation Bible School at the church. Anyway, we had a lot of fun. We made messes, but we were cleaning them up. Anyway, Emily's been doing a great job of cleaning up the downstairs. She repainted her rooms to get them prepared for the children this year. Every year, seeing those faces come through, it's so heartwarming to see them smiling, laughing. And if you show up for programs throughout the year, when they're singing songs about Jesus, it is exciting. It really, inside of me, it excites me. It makes me want to be a better Christian, actually. So anyway, we're getting ready for preschool open house. The dates are August 8th, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., August 10th, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., August 15th, same, 10 to 2, and August 17th, the same, 10 to 2. Also, August 19th at 6 o'clock, we are going to be having a family farm night or fun on the farm night. You remember the evening on the lawn? Very similar. We're inviting everybody, not just the preschool, not just the kids. We're inviting everyone to come out. Bring a lawn chair. We're going to have hot dogs. We're going to have food.
Does that include them?
Yes, everybody. Oh. Everybody. It's going to be a fun time.
I'm not sure they like to have fun.
Oh, they like to have fun. Jim Carbon likes to have fun. I know that.
Carbon, we're looking for you.
It's going to be a good time. Come out. It's just going to be a fun time. Bring a lawn chair. We're going to have hot dogs, food, some games for the kids. It'll just be a fun social time, and it's also an opportunity to meet some of these preschool kids and their families. That concludes my announcements.
Thank you. No, I'm announced. Listen, thanks for asking.
prayer of illumination. God of life, your Spirit raised Jesus from the dead, inspired the writers of the scripture, draws us to Christ, and helps us to acknowledge him as Lord. We ask that you send your Spirit now to give us insight, encouragement, faith, and hope through the proclamation of the gospel. Amen. The scripture readings today from the Old Testament, we'll hear from Genesis 2, verse 18, and then the history, we'll have Acts 2, verses 42 through 47. Genesis. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." And then from Acts. They devoted themselves to the apostles, teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute them, the proceeds, to all as they had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God, having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Thanks. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
The passage that Jeff read from Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, you hear it a lot of weddings. It's about man and woman, but it's really about humankind, men and women. So the word they're used for man is not for Adama or Adama or Adam for man or woman. It's the word for humankind. So God is saying to us, we're all in need of community. We're all in need of being together. Not just married people. The church provides an avenue for that being together, especially from a Christian perspective. So I'm reading this book 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, about life in the world today, especially life in the church. And there is these, just happen to be middle-aged women having a discussion at their women's group about the state of affairs in the world today, especially in the church. And the echoing reply was over and over, somebody has to do something. Or the other one, they, as in the church leaders, they have to do something. And this one middle-aged woman realizes, we are they. In other words, yeah, we have to do something. It's fallen upon us. And just because we don't have to do what we did in the 50s doesn't mean we don't have to do something today that fits in the culture we're living today. We have to do something. As the ladies wisely spoke, somebody has to do something. Our kids are just fragmented, and we're not raising them like we used to. We're not raising them like we could today either. The reason behind intentional Christian community, a writer named Carolyn DeKetta, who has a quote on the front of the bulletin, I want to add some other quotes from her right here. God himself is a community of three persons in one, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, who exist in perfect unity. So it is not surprising that from the beginning, God created us to be in community with one another. Genesis 12, 18 states, it is not good for man, humankind, people in general, to be alone. Part of our cultural problem in the United States is we are a culture that is far too often alone. We are also a culture that worships our individuality so much so we've lost the understanding that we are who we are because we're together. That's one of the phrases in the early church about who they were as a church. We are who we are because we are together. Not we are who we are because we're such fabulous individuals. No, we are who we are, fabulous individuals, because we've chosen to be together. We've lost that as a culture. We've lost that as a church. Small groups is intentionally put together to allow us to bring that back in. One way, not the only way, not the best way, but a way to bring that back into the body of Christ. Community, she says, is deeply grounded in the nature of God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They're in community. Why aren't we? Community is deeply grounded in the nature of God. It grows from who God is. Because he is community, he creates community. It is his gift of himself to humans. Therefore, the making of community may not be regarded as an optional decision for Christians. So I'll read that again. Therefore, The making of community may not be regarded as an optional decision for humans. It is a compelling and irrevocable necessity, a binding divine mandate for all believers at all times. We become like Jesus, not because we're such great individuals at home. We become like Jesus because we rub up against other people that want to become like Jesus, and we agree with them or we disagree with them, but the rub or the hugs is what makes us like Jesus. We can't do it alone. And we're trying to do it alone. No wonder we're failing so often, nationwide, as a church, and in Uniontown, at this place called Trinity. We're too alone. We're not rubbing up against each other often enough. We're not challenging each other, supporting each other. We're not there for each other often enough. As she says, the reason behind intentional Christian community is this. Small groups is one way of doing that. And if you got a better plan, if you got a better plan for us to grow stronger in Jesus and be together like God is, then let's do it. Until you have a better plan than small groups. If we don't have it, I quoted myself here, if we don't have it, then we must create it. If we don't have a better plan than small groups, and we want people to grow and mature and become like Jesus together with us, then let's do that plan. But until we got a better plan, we need to do this one. We're celebrating small groups this month and signing people up for those small groups. Next month, there's a poster in the chapel about the new young adult small group. Those people are young adults. They're about, what, 17 and 18? They realize it. They've come to James and they said, we need this. We need to be together. We want to be Christians. They're going out into a hostile world. It is not a pleasant place to be 17 and 18 right now if you want to be like Jesus. There is a lot of pressure, and they realize that. And they've petitioned James and our church to create this adult small group so they can grow and develop as believers and not just be squashed by the culture. If we don't have it, then we must create it. I've been saying that for years, many times, many years. And what you'll see here in these passages of Acts, the reason that Carolyn brings has been stated at the beginning, but the idea of devotion, togetherness in the body of Christ, continued commitment, and enjoying one another is what these four passages are about. And if you came to visit me in scenic Hopwood with my dog, very pleasant homestead there we have, I don't know what's up with butterflies. Maybe you could bring it to my understanding after the worship, but there is a bunch of butterflies around the house that I rent in Hopwood now for the last 2 weeks. I don't know what's up with these butterflies. Maybe you could come and tell me what's up with these very colorful, very numerous butterflies around over across the street in the woods, over in the yard I rent. I'm not used to seeing these guys. So I'm thinking, something's going on here. And I'm thinking it's either transformational or it's metamorphosis going on, because we all know that metamorphosis is how butterflies change from a cocoon into a butterfly. We all know that. And we also know that many of these butterfly species flap their little wings all the way from here to South America. Can you imagine that? Talk about a journey. And we complain about having to drive into church once a week. They're flying to another continent. Transformational, gradual change with a plan. small groups, gradual change of the believers in Christ, strengthening, encouraging, challenging each other, rubbing against each other with a plan to become more and more like Jesus. Transformational. Metamorphosis. Rapid change with a plan. One day, the dang butterfly is a cocoon, minding his own business in his little cocoon deal after he was a caterpillar, and he's in there. Can you imagine the radical change going on inside that cocoon, where one day the cocoon kind of cracks, and this guy that was totally fine with being a cocoon crawls out, and he's got what on his back? Wings! And he's no longer stuck on the earth, and he can now fly. Metamorphosis is rapid change. Transformation is gradual change. They're both of the plan, and God's in control. We are being called to small groups. We are being called to make and nurture disciples of Jesus. And if you got a better way, we want to hear it in Christian Ed. If you don't have a better way, then we want to see you where? In small groups that you and I and we will create for each other. I'm telling you, you become more, I'm stating a fact right here. You become much more like Jesus rubbing up against other saints than you do adjusting the channel on your TV at home. Of course, unless it's the Beverly Hillbillies, which I know a lot of us watch a lot of. Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. They devoted themselves to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to praying together. They devoted themselves. Devoted means priority. Devotion means make something a priority with God in mind, under God's direction. That's the definition that I'm working with here. Devotion is a priority, making something a priority, top of your to-do list or near the top of your to-do list with God in mind, under God's direction. That's what devotion is. And that's what the early church committed themselves to. Number one, to be a part of the disciples' teaching. Number two, to be a part of fellowship. Number three, to be in prayer and worship with one another. That's why they took over the world. You want to take over Uniontown? Or you want to let it go to HE double hockey sticks? I want to see a hand if you want to take over Uniontown, or if you're just fine the way it is. I got one hand, two hands, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So are we going to do something about it? Or are we just going to say, oh, that'd be a good idea. Somebody else ought to do it. We ought to do something about that. No, they ought to do something about that so we can continue doing nothing. Got my point? We have to do something about this problem. And people will respond, just like they did in Jerusalem in chapter 2 of Acts. People want that. If we provide that and we come to it, like the Friday night at the farm, if we provide that and we come to it and have fun together with our preschool and their parents and their family and their kids, we're going to have fun together. Who doesn't want to do that? We have to do it. We're done with the they have to do it, because the they is not working. We have to do that work. Yeah, I'm kind of worked up about this today, because I see it not happening, and we have to do this. This is our calling. The believers were together. All the believers, not just one or two of them, all of them, the totality of the believers were together and had everything in common. I mean, they weren't doing all the stuff all the time, but they were all connected most or some of the time. All the believers were together and had something and everything in common. The church in the United States today is hurting big time. Not just the PCUSA. We're hurting big time. We have to do something about that. The church in the United States today, the number one need in the church today is worship. They call it worship is job one. We have to provide worship that meets the needs of people. We have to worship with vigor and vitality and joy. Doesn't matter what type of worship you have, what type of songs you have. It matters that you do it vigorously and you do it with joy and you bring your friends because there's something for them here besides being a number in a pew. Like my old buddy Scott always said, what did he always say? He always said, we're not here to listen to the music. We're here to sing it. And if Scott can say that as an old rock and roller, that he loves to sing the hymns with vigor, I think Scott could out-sing our whole church. He sings with vigor because it's in here. And he brings his friends. And they come back. Oh, what a shocking thing. So worship is job number one. So getting behind these hymns, getting behind these singers, these choir people, celebrating what we have is job number one. Providing that to other people is job number one. Number two, when they come, intentionally welcome people is job number two. In other words, like you said, Nancy, we need ushers in the parking lot. We need signs outside so when people come because they want to be with folks like us that worship Jesus with vigor, and they want to be a part of that. They got the Beverly Hillbillies at home. They're not coming for that. They want to be with us and Jesus. And when they come to that parking lot, like you said, we need ushers over there pointing them to how to get in here. How many people do you think know how to get in the six doors of our church? We had a wedding here yesterday. Nobody knew how to get in. I went out. I kind of pointed them to the right door or two. There's three doors they can use. But out there, they don't know where. They're almost like, well, they must not want me in here because I don't know how to get in. That's exactly what people think about our edifice called a building. They don't know how to get in, so therefore they assume we don't want them in and we're some kind of exquisitely fancy club that has excluded them because they don't have the secret passage numbers on how to get in our building. Number one, worship is job one, vigorously, whatever kind of music you have. Number two, intentionally welcome people into the church. Be out there welcoming them in, getting a sign or two, pointing them to the right way. And then once they get in, say, we're glad you're here. Welcome to worship with the Church of Jesus Christ. We're so glad you came. You know, Presbyterians, they joke about us. They call us blue bloods, and they call us sour pusses. You think there's some truth to that? What do you think? You're looking out here every Sunday. I'm looking out here every Sunday. I see some smiles. I tell pretty good stories. And they barely ever even smirk. Just saying. Acts 2:46. Every day. Not just Sunday, not just once in a while, not maybe, you know, our denomination says you're an active member if you come more than once or twice a year and you give money. Is that what you want to define active membership as? I'm getting kind of worked up here, all right? Do you think an active member comes once or twice a year? No, I would say they're on life supports if they're not here every week or every month. We're shooting ourselves in our foot. We've defined active membership as people that never come. I knew a Methodist pastor named Hugh Hubbard in my first church. I served out of seminary, wherever, and he was a hoot. This guy was a hoot, and so was his wife. I forgot his wife. Julie, I think her wife. Anyway, they're from Pennsylvania. They served in Ohio, and he was a hardliner. On Christmas, you always have your Christmas people and your Easter people, and he knew who they were, a very small church he had, and so he knew when the C&Es, he called them, showed up. And he would stand at the back door of the church on Christmas Eve, and he would say, "See you on Easter." And on Easter, he would say to the C&Es, "See you Christmas Eve." They hated that. But it's true. Going twice a year is not active membership. Giving money is not active membership. Because God doesn't need your money. He needs you. He needs your heart. He needs your head. Continue to meet together. Again, 2:46. Every day they continue to meet together in the temple courts. Every day. At least maybe once a month. Do you think the Apostle Paul would look at our denomination, our church, and say, these folks are active. They're going to take over the world. They're learning about Jesus so much, it's just going to come out of them. You think that's what it's going to see? We are they. Small groups use transformational relationships, change gradually over the course of time, encouraging, empowering, and rubbing up against each other, talking about the Bible, talking about each other, sharing your lives, praying for one another, and looking at the Bible. That's all it is. Moving on with God. Do you feel that is where you are? Have you moved on with God? Have you learned things about God? Have you matured? Have you grown? Have you developed with God in the last 2 or 3 years? Or are you about the same as you were? What do you think God thinks about your progress? You feel you're moving on with God? With your devotional state of mind right now? Do you feel that is where God wants you to be right now? What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do that's better than getting in a small group? Remember, these small groups that we're developing, they're, correct me if I'm wrong here, James, but they're going to have Bible, the Word, they're going to have prayer for each other, supporting one another, interceding for one another, and supporting each other, and sharing our lives. And they're going to do Bible, and they're going to do small groups, they're going to do devotions, they're going to do friendships, they're going to go places together, they're going to have field trips. The adult group we're planting in the middle of September is going to do the same thing. They're going to have Word, prayer, share. They're going to go on field trips. They're going to have fun times. They're going to go out to eat on occasion. They're going to go to somebody's house on occasion. They're going to meet regularly, but they're not always going to do Bible studies. They're going to mix it up because that's what the culture wants. They want groups that want to be together because they're fun. We can do this. Oh, the cover. I'm sure you read this and you got scared. Word, prayer, share. Small groups exist as a way for people to engage in biblical community that helps them become more like Jesus in every area of their life. So, you want to be more like Jesus, or are you just fine with who you are? I look at myself in the mirror and I say, I want to be more like Jesus. Helps them become more like Jesus in every area of their lives. It is in small groups that people can get close enough to know each other. each other, to share and care, to challenge and support, to confide and confess, to forgive and be forgiven, to laugh and weep together, to be accountable to each other, to watch over each other, and to grow together. Personal growth does not happen in isolation. It is a result of interactive relationships. Small groups are God's gift to foster changes in character and spiritual growth. Fosters changes in character. We become more like Jesus, enjoying the favor of all the people. From 27, then I will close, verse 47. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people in Jerusalem with glad and sincere hearts. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. God works through surprising situations. And we're going to go to prayer here as I give you one last short illustration from Chicago, Illinois. I was aware of a group called Jesus People USA in Chicago, Illinois. I met some of their Jesus people in college. They call themselves Jesus people. They came out in a dilapidated school bus from California about 1968 out of the burgeoning move of the Jesus people, hippies in California that met Jesus and changed their lives. They got a school bus, they got all together and they drove out, and you never guess why they stayed in Chicago, because they were headed to Boston. Their bus broke down. Oh, they're hippies. They didn't have any money. So guess what? They just stayed right there on Rush Street, downtown Chicago, one of the worst neighborhoods in that section of Chicago. I've been there. It's a hoot. These people don't fit in anywhere. They are all different. They are all very unusual looking. They got people with suits and ties. They got people with all kinds of dated clothes from the 60s. It is a complete mishmash of people. Now they have their own building where lots of them live together, like it says in Acts chapter 2. They've chosen to make that. They don't expect people to do that. They've chosen to do that. They have 21 ministries that go out of their building every week. How are we doing? Can we compare to that? Not that we should compare ourselves to other believers. We're sure to lose once we start doing that. But the point is, they want to grow and look like Jesus, and they've decided to commit their lives to it. And we complain because we can't get here more than once a week. And those butterflies fly to South America. We pray, Lord Jesus, you'll be with us, encourage us, inspire us, light a fire under us, remind us that if Jesus People USA, that is so diverse, can do it, we can do it right here. We don't have to have our own building. We don't have to have 21 ministries going on outside of our building every week. We just need to do what you want us to do. Let us do what you want us to do, Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Pause. Thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Again, God works his glory out through his people. Let us stand and say the affirmation of faith. And then we have a minute for mission from myself and James. What is it then that we believe? By his resurrection, Christ broke the gates of death and opened to us the way of life. He announced victory to the disciples and brought salvation to the whole earth, thereby annihilating the power of death and renewing creation, giving us the promise of resurrection that we will rise with him in new life. Please be seated. This is just a reminder that our kickoff is coming and sign-up sheets will be available towards the end of this month as we go into September. And they will be your opportunities, your chances to sign up for small groups that seem to fit what you're looking for. And they'll be about the Bible. They'll be about sharing our lives together. They'll be about praying one for another. And the group will have a lot of control as to what days they're going to meet, what times they're going to meet, how often they're going to meet, and they will also have authority over how long they're going to meet. We're recommending an hour, hour and 10 minutes or so, but the group can say, no, we want to go for 45 minutes. No, we'd like to go for an hour and a half. That's up to you, because it's your group, because it's your group of folks that are growing and developing and rubbing off each other as you become like Jesus. And as we do that, guess what we're going to notice in our church? What do you think is going to happen here?
Relationships. We're going to grow.
Yeah. Happens when you got relationships going.
Everyone grows.
Yeah, you got somebody to invite to church. And you got somebody, when you do invite somebody to church, I can introduce you to the Springers, not the Simpsons. Sorry about that. And you need relationships or else you're alone. And so the purpose of the small groups will be to help us develop relationships that work, not forced. James, Youth Ministries.
Encouragement. This morning in Sunday school, we spoke about encouragement. We spoke about Nichelle Nichols, if that's a name. That's a name that's been brought up a lot this week. For those of you that don't know, Nichelle Nichols just passed away this past week. She was Lieutenant Uhura in the original Star Trek series. Anyway, going along with encouragement here. She was one of the only starring black actresses in Hollywood. And she was ready to quit because, you know, lesser roles, not as much screen time. But she was encouraged by none other than Dr. Martin Luther King, who encouraged her that she was the only black representation that many were seeing on TV at that time. She's famous for her interracial kiss with Captain Kirk in 1968. She was encouraged to keep going. And she continued that encouragement when she became a recruiter for NASA. She recruited over 8,000 people for NASA. Encouragement is huge. A couple weeks ago here, I asked if you could fill this sheet out and then put it in the offering. And we got a lot of amazing responses, a lot of great encouraging words. I keep using the word encouragement because our young people, they're in need of it. So I'm going to read some of these. I'm not going to read all of them. I'm going to read out a few of these, and I will be sharing all the words with the kids. But for you this morning, I just wanted to share some of the encouragement and some of the advice that you had for them. Patience. Be more willing to forgive. Try not to worry. Trust in God. Don't hold yourself back. Trust that God can do so much through you. Never stop reaching out for the lost. Study harder. Get more education. Be careful who your friends are. And not to sweat the small stuff. And these are just a few of the cards that were written out to our kids. Encouragement, though, is so huge. So going with small groups, we're starting a small group in September for the young ones, they're adults. We're going to be building relationships. We're going to be encouraging them because it's going to get tough in life. There are hills and valleys. There are difficulties. There are challenges. But it's words like this that can keep somebody going. And what's amazing with the relationships, when we build those and we start coming to church with one another, you don't have to write these down on a card to share with them. You're able just to share with them in person. And that's what our young people need.
Thank you. Nice. This is impromptu. What do you think is a better way to get those points across that are very good? If we send them in an email? If we sent them in a text, if we wrote out a little epistle and sent it to everybody and expected them to do it on their own, or we picked one of those things a week and had a small group around helping people realize their failures and their victories in that area and sharing that with one another and backing it up with some Bible knowledge of where that comes from. What do you think? Think we should do the email?
No, no.
What about the text?
No, absolutely not.
What about me standing out front of the church shouting it at the street?
Oh, heavens no. Oh, gosh.
So the idea is small groups. Yeah. Get that through.
Absolutely.
And so where we don't have biblical community, we have to create it.
Absolutely.
And the we are those.
Yeah, we are the we.
Thank you for fielding my questions. Let us now share of our tithes and offerings with the Lord Jesus Christ, not forgetting that we are called to share ourselves. Use us, Lord. We are the people. We are desirous of being your workers in your creation of community, in your creation of your church. We are they, and we want to do it. Encourage us, empower us, and lift us up so we can serve. Use these tithes, these offerings, these dollars to that end also. In your holy name we pray, amen. And before we go to the last hymn, I'd have a question. Who is this Johann Erasmus Kinderman?
The German composer from the era, the Baroque era.
Well, you could probably tell me some stuff about not only Johann, but Baroque. And I could probably converse with you about some Erasmus information from the Enlightenment. So we could have a small group right here just around those couple names. And I could tell you about Johann from college. He was a hoot, but a rock-solid believer in Jesus, and he scared people just by showing up. So we could have a little small group right here talking about fun biblical things. That's what small groups do. They talk about fun biblical things and give you a chance to share your life and your joys with each other. We got to do this. The world's not doing it. We got to do it, and young kids aren't getting it. Thank you. Johann Erasmus. Number 438, Blessed Be the Ties That Bind. It's great to sing it. It's even better to do it in the Church of Jesus Christ. May God bless you and keep you. May God give you a great, most victorious week. Amen.